Hello and welcome to Showcase. Today, Utopia, Pompidou, and David Hockney.
Where is Utopia?
I'm Jessica. Amazon Prime Americanizers Britain's Utopia. Then, the future is unclear for France's Centre Pompidou. And Britain's Royal Opera House has a garage sale to get out of a financial hole. The original Utopia TV show was released almost 10 years ago. It became an instant cult classic. And like most successful British television, it now has an American remake. But purists, they might not be fans.
It's all over now.
They're starting again.
As of today, we are making the vaccine, and this will happen at an...
Utopia is the brainchild of British wordsmith Dennis Kelly. The series follows the story of a group of people who are brought together by a graphic novel. The bizarre comic book predicts epidemics that happen in real life, and it's rumored to have information about important future events as well. The group's investigation into the book eventually results in them being tracked down by a deep state organization called The Network.
We all have our purpose.
With its dark narrative and shocking visuals, the show was an instant cult hit and even won an international Emmy. But it was also deemed too violent for television by some viewers. After two seasons, it got the axe. Now, almost a decade later, Amazon Prime is aiming for a remake. The differences are noticeable. For starters, the Americanized casting changes the races of its lead characters. Ian, played by Dan Bird, is now a white man, whereas Ashley LaThrope's Becky is black. And there are a few plot changes. For instance, Jessica Hyde carries out a murder that she did not commit in the original. There are other differences as well. At first, fans thought two other main characters from the original ensemble piece were missing, Michael and Christian. But it turns out the two leads have been combined in the form of Dr. Michael in the new version. From a stylistic point of view, the new Utopia is described to be lighter in tone. It has less blood. The guts and gore were the main reasons why the original got in trouble in the first place. Some purists are upset. Taking the differences into consideration, maybe this Utopia was not necessarily dreamed up for the cult of the original, but like other American reimaginings, for a much wider audience.
None evil.
Let's talk to filmmaker and writer for Black Nerd Problems, Skylar Ezell. Hi, Skylar. It's lovely to see you. Hello. So, is this good timing to drop this, you think?
I don't think it is, but it's kind of hard to blame blame Amazon for that. You know, no, they couldn't have predicted what was to come. You know, none of us could. That being said, considering the source material and just the state that the world is in now in terms of disinformation, fear about the ongoing coronavirus pandemic, I think it might have been a wiser move for Amazon to maybe hold off on this for maybe a year or so, just to see where things shake out and to then maybe premiere it. You know, there, when you watch each episode, there's a disclaimer that comes on explaining that this is a work of fiction, none of this is real, and we all know why that's there. So if you have to put that there, it sort of makes you think, well, then why don't you just wait and save it? Why did it have to come out now? And the interesting part about it too is Amazon has done virtually no promotion for this show. I haven't seen very many ads for it. I haven't seen very many interviews or anything related to it. So it's almost like they know that this might be a problematic time to drop this, so they're not going to come right out and give it the marketing that it deserves, which is just another reason why maybe they should have waited a year or so.
Yeah. So despite the disclaimer being there, do you think Utopia still could contribute to the fear atmosphere around?
I think so. It's it's hard to answer that. I guess you have to answer that in two frames of mind, right? For someone who can appreciate a work of art for what it is, it's fine. You know, it's not that big of a deal. I guess the issue is there are people out there that really hold on to some of these conspiracy theories. Like and it's hard to reason with those people. And so for those folks, it's sort of like you have to think on a whole new plane to sort of understand where they're coming from. So it's a tough one. There's not really an easy answer. I think the easiest answer would have been just to leave it alone. I don't know if it adds anything of value. Yeah. Because, you know, honestly, and this might be a bad analogy, but it's almost as if like QAnon, which is a popular, growing in popularity, far right wing news outlet you guys probably know about. It's almost as if like QAnon got its own like TV show or something, and it's just like, no, we don't want to validate this at all. And I don't know if it adds anything to the conversation.
Okay, Skylar, you say that it's hard to blame Amazon Prime, but Time Magazine seems like it doesn't agree with you because they say this show exploits some of contemporary civilization's greatest anxieties without saying anything worth hearing about them, without giving an analysis. Do you think this is too harsh of a criticism?
So on the topic of conspiracy theories, I think they're actually right. I think Time is pretty spot on. They in the show, it's very plot driven. There's a lot of story, a lot of good story. You know, overall, it's a good story to get through, but it doesn't really peel back the onion about why people believe the things that they do, how some of these conspiracy theories can be hurtful. It also, you know, if I'm being completely honest too, it's also not fair to people who do believe in these conspiracy theories. And I might be wrong for saying this, but people believe conspiracies because there have been things in our past that have been true, right? So take, for example, the Tuskegee experiment here in the States, where African-American soldiers were not given treatment for syphilis because America wanted to see what the consequences of that would be, right? Like, that sounds like a conspiracy theory, but it happened. So I can see where people have those thoughts, but the show doesn't really explain why I can feel the way that they do. But what the show does do, which I think that Time criticism is missing, is the show does delve into other topics that I think are important, like income inequality, mm-hmm. the environment, mm-hmm. power that large corporations, you know, like honestly, like Amazon, yeah. the kinds of power these organizations have to have undue influence on our politics, undue influences on our education system and all sorts of things. So while the show doesn't do a great job dealing with the conspiracy aspect and getting into that, it does do a good job exploring everything else.
So did you enjoy it overall, or are you giving a mixed review?
It's a little mixed, but I enjoyed the show. If this had been in a different year, I would give this a mostly positive review. I've noticed that some of the reviews were kind of mixed in terms of what it was. I think some of that was also maybe a comparison to the original British BBC show that ran earlier in like the 2010s for a couple of seasons. So I haven't seen that one, so I don't have anything to compare it to. Overall, I would say that the show it's definitely good. It's definitely an interesting watch, as long as you're not into conspiracy theories. And to be honest, if you're into mysteries and sci-fi, you get to follow along with these characters to sort of see if you can solve the mystery before they do, as far as what the big conspiracy is and what's happening. So I think the show is a good show overall. It's definitely a show worth watching. I think it does deserve another season, you know, if Amazon hasn't made the decision to pick it up yet. But it does have areas where it's lacking. Like I said, it's a lot of plots, and they're sticking a lot of story only into like 6 or 7 episodes. So, mm-hmm. you know, there's pluses and minuses, but overall, I enjoyed it.
You enjoyed it. All right, Skylar, I appreciate your time. Thanks a lot for speaking to us today. Eddie Van Halen's widow says she never knew it was possible to cry so many, many tears or feel such incredible sadness. The feelings were shared by rock icons Ozzy Osbourne, Metallica, Pearl Jam, and so many others, as one of their own died earlier this week of cancer.
Eddie Van Halen, considered one of rock music's greatest guitar players and founding member of the hugely successful rock band named after him and his drummer brother, died of cancer on Tuesday. His son Wolfgang tweeted the news, writing, quote, "I can't believe I'm having to write this, but my father, Edward Ludwig Van Halen, has lost his long and arduous battle with cancer this morning." Van Halen was known for his dizzyingly fast, virtuosic shredding, and his innovative tapping technique has inspired thousands of hard-rocking teens since the late 70s. The band was most well-known for songs like Jump, Right Now, and the instrumental Eruption, which decades later is still Van Halen's best-known solo. Eddie Van Halen was 65 years old.
France has its cultural institutions covered when it comes to the economic losses suffered from COVID-19. But in the case of the Centre Pompidou, there are other big issues. The Parisian landmark could fully or partially close for several years, starting in 2023, as it needs major renovations. Unlike other repairs that has caused its closure in the past, this one will be the most extensive one to date, according to the institution's president. The makeover for the iconic complex built in 1977 is expected to cost over $235 million. But it could take the government months to hatch an actual plan. Let's talk to Francesco Proto, senior lecturer in architecture at Oxford Brookes University. Hi, lovely to have you. Thanks a lot for joining us. So my first question is, a potential 3-year closure for Centre Pompidou could cost roughly $200 million. So I feel like it is a risky time for it, don't you think?
Absolutely, it is. And of course, the pandemic has already put a blow on the building because of the loss they've been facing. There were millions of euros lost during the past 3 months. So 3 more years of closure could be really a problem with the Pompidou. But it's true also is that the building was structured originally to be hyper-flexible, and therefore maybe there's something that can be done in that direction.
Okay, what does hyper-flexible mean in this context?
Hyper-flexible, well, we need to understand the building within the culture of the time, 60s and the 70s, where something called a megastructuralist movement would be thought within architecture to solve all the issues of progressing urban design and advancements of technology. Hyperflexible means that the building was built and conceived to accommodate all sorts of events, of happenings, but also all sorts of issues arising around the city. To understand that the building was built in response to the 68 students' revolution that inflamed the whole world during those same times. So it's born out of a crisis, if you like.
That is very interesting. I'll come back to that. But then you say that this is a hyper-flexible building and this is a time of a pandemic. So tell us, why do you think it was so necessary to make all these renovations right now?
Probably because the building was built as an ephemeral building. It was not supposed to last for that long, only possibly for 40 years or less, the time span of a ship, and therefore now they decided to turn the building from an ephemeral structure into a monument. A monument not just to architecture, but to culture overall. And possibly the political implication of culture when we talk about people's freedom. Therefore, given its importance has been growing up during the times, at the time the building was harshly opposed by Parisians, who only later learned to appreciate the building due to the immense success and unexpected success he finally had, they decided to keep the building. And this is the first time that actually they're thinking about restructuring, not the outside, because it happened just a few years ago, but the facade.
Okay, why do you think it is a successful building?
It's a success, well, depends on the viewpoint. So when the building was first built, it was supposed to be quite old because it was bringing to completion ideas that were already 10 years old. So it didn't also engage with the future of architecture, which is digital rather than analogic. But nevertheless, it managed to embody the spirit of the time. In German would be the Zeitgeist, which means it meant he managed to embody the importance that culture had to play in everybody's life. And also the idea that culture finally had to be fun, as opposed to the old conception of the museum, which at a time were extremely dusty and empty.
Okay, so you said that it was a response to a crisis as well, and now it is a time of crisis. In that sense, what do you think the building should look like, or what should change after the renovation?
Well, the problem is not structural, because the building has been so successful that it now has become a monument to itself, a monument to architecture, a monument to technological advancements, a monument to freedom, a monument to the political uprise that happened at the time. And therefore, the building should be respected for what it is. The problem would be more about thinking of how the building may avoid to collapse on itself, because the number of institutions that the building is at a time accommodating are increasing and increasing and increasing. And even the number of the spectators that originally were supposed to be just one third of the one that the buildings accommodate daily. So what needs to be rethought is the position of the building within the heart of the city and the way in which possibly other satellite structure may support it.
Okay, Francesco, why don't you tell me why it takes so long to renovate it? I mean, we're talking several years here.
Okay, this is the first building of its kind, and possibly we haven't got any much of that same kind. So it was highly experimental. When the Italian architect Richard Renzo Piano and the British architect Richard Rogers decided to build the building, they were a little bit more than students. They were not expecting absolutely to win the competition. So they went for something that were absolutely outstanding and unusual for the time. This is the first building of its kind. This can be defined as an inside-out structure, because all the structural elements of the building actually have been put on the outside. This was done in order for the building to be completely empty within the inside and therefore become flexible. That's why the name hyperflexibility is. In the original building, the floors even were supposed to be moving up and down, but then when the president Pompidou died, his successor, Giscard d'Estaing, immensely reduced the budget of the building. Therefore, the movable floors went. Still, the flexibility of the building is still there, because every few years they decide to change completely the props for the exhibitions. But again, this also means that the most important structural parts of the building are completely outside, exposed to the elements, and nothing has been done, especially on the main facade, for 40 years. That's why it's absolutely vital that they do something about it now.
Francesco, this was really helpful. Thanks a lot. When the Genoese built Istanbul's Galata Tower in the 14th century, it was meant to be a watchtower. Since then, this landmark has been turned into a museum under a recent renovation.
Following a three-month restoration, Istanbul's Galata Tower has been reopened as a museum. And the reopening coincided with a special date, the 97th anniversary of Istanbul's independence. The tower used to merely function as a place of entertainment. Now the restaurant and cafe inside have been removed, along with tons of concrete from previous restorations. And the tower's function has been majorly improved.
The last time Galata Tower underwent an extensive restoration was in 1967. The structure was then designed to function as entertainment. Today it's been redesigned as a museum and exhibition space. From now on, Galata Tower will be used not just as a center of attraction, but as a place that preserves and guides other important cultural assets in Istanbul.
From now on, visitors will reach the tower's terrace by elevator and use the stairs to climb down. The landmarks that can be seen from the panoramic view are further promoted at the exhibition spaces.
İstanbul'un tarihi çok eski.
Istanbul is an ancient city with a rich history. There's now a permanent show about the timeline of the city. They are also temporary exhibition space, which will mark the important dates for the city and the country.
The minister says restorations in Istanbul will continue around the Galata Tower, ending with the completion of a much-anticipated Atatürk Cultural Center in Taksim.
Earlier this week, we talked about how the Royal Academy of Arts rejected the idea of selling a Michelangelo statue to save jobs. The Royal Opera House, however, thinks such a sale could fix its problems. Nursena has more.
London's Royal Opera House is rolling up its sleeves and getting ready to raise cash to get out of a financial jam. The devastating effects of COVID-19 shutdowns made many art institutions take drastic steps. And as part of what they call a four-pronged pandemic recovery plan, they're selling a 1971 painting by David Hockney. It's a portrait of David Webster, who ran the Royal Opera House from 1945 to 1970. So, this sale has an added dose of meaning for the institution.
The Royal Opera House obviously is in a very fortunate position in that they are really a performing arts centre, but did have this wonderful painting by David Hockney, and actually that Sir David Webster was a figure who was so important in building the Royal Opera House. The fact that his portrait is almost beyond the grave, he's coming to the rescue. So I think a lot of cultural institutions will have to take a similar approach. But each time, of course, it has to be a decision that's very well thought through.
The piece will be auctioned at Christie's later this month. Christie's says it could fetch about $20 million.
You know, Hockney is one of the greatest colourists of our time. He knows how to use colour to brilliant effect. And in this moment of the 1970s, it really is spectacular. The tulips are ruby red, the eye of Sir David Webster a brilliant blue-grey, the pocket scarf in cerulean blue, it's just fabulous.
Alex Beard, the Royal Opera House's chief executive, says the Hockney sale is just one vital part of the strategy. Costs are also being cut, fundraising from patrons is taking place, and government aid is being applied for. Just how much it will help depends on how long the coronavirus sticks around.
Look at any movie that shows black history and you're likely going to see black people getting beaten, whipped, and killed. That is grounded in real life, but a new film says there is more to black cinema than showing racial violence.
What kind of play we want to write?
A new type of film emerged in recent years. Critics dubbed it the Black Renaissance. It aims to expose the racism and violence faced by black people. And it does this with realistic violent imagery. But director Rada Blank wants to change this in the 40-year version. In the film, the lead character argues that blacks shouldn't always be subjected to violence in movies. She says there should be more to their on-screen representation, and concludes by adding that white audiences only want to see black people suffer in cinema. The 40-year-old version follows a struggling playwright who decides to reinvent herself as a rapper. Blank puts herself in the main role. She sets out to write a play on Harlem's gentrification, but producers want to hire a white lead. Retta is also asked if she'd be interested in doing a play about Harriet Tubman. In the end, she writes a hip-hop song called Poverty Porn, which includes the lyrics, "No happy black people in the plot lines, please," but a crane shot of Big Mama crying on her knees. The Guardian gave the film good marks. The review highlights how Hollywoodized accounts of black history impose danger on black people by defining them by their suffering and oppression. And the British paper points out that the 40-year-old version proves racism in movies can be discussed without black people being tortured.
40-year-old version.
That's it on this episode of Showcase. Our YouTube channel, Insta and Twitter page has more from the world of culture and the arts. I'm Ilfere Ketli. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.